This is Hacking the Afterlife podcast with Jennifer Shaffer. Jennifer!
Richard!
How are you? I don't know where I came up with that initial thing of me just shouting your name into the ether.
I don't know, but it's so funny. Sorry.
I don't know. It just feels like, you know, we're on stage. We have to go.
There we go.
Anyways, welcome to our podcast, Hacking the Afterlife, where we talk to all kinds of people on the other side of the veil.
Yes, we do. Hey, so I want to, sorry about my headset. There's concrete being destroyed outside my office right now.
Very good.
You're doing
no
something
worries.
With the telephone lines. Super fun. I'm just hoping that none of the technology goes down like it has been. Because of that, they're rewiring everything.
Knock on wood.
But.
Yes.
How was your weekend? How was your weekend?
How was my weekend? It was, oh my gosh.
Go ahead. Yeah, since you go to the desert, you went to the desert,
we did,
right?
Here's the thing. So Sherry, about 6 months ago, was like, I want to go to this thing, you know, Contact in the Desert. It's like
awesome.
Authors about, you know, alien abduction and Area 51. Not my cup of tea. But as I've learned in my work with you.
Neither was mediumship.
There was mediumship.
When I first talked to you, you're like, I'm sorry. Nah, not doing the whole medium thing. I've already been there.
That's exactly what I said. And you were like, okay.
With less enthusiasm too, by the way.
And here we are 8 years later, the conversation continuing. So I had a great time. Yay you. I went out there. I met a couple of authors, Paul Hynek. So that's the unusual part of that is we interviewed J. Allen Hynek some time ago. That's his father who was responsible for the project.
By the way, Luana, so.
Go ahead.
Luana's like, this is what we want to talk about.
Well, I love that she's just like, Richard, enough about you. Okay, great. Go ahead. Lou, you're up.
No. I think about the weekend, I believe.
I know why. It. Okay, so very good. I do want to.
For the people that are going to be there for the first time or last time listening to our fabulous podcast, we don't discuss anything about what we're going to talk about ever.
No.
Our thread on our phone says, hey, what time today?
Because
my time always changes. And if you see me look down, I have Luana's name. Okay. That's it. I'm here. I'm just mad because I actually thought I was coming up with the whole questions, but I guess I wasn't. They're the ones who gave it to me. So how about your weekend? They put it in my head. Oh yeah, you went there.
Okay. Well, it's fascinating because I do have some questions for Luana and her crew and the people that help us with the podcast. And the reason for that is because while we were in Indian Wells, where they had this Ron Janix, Captain Ron is now running the show, and he's a friend. Anyway, what happened was while I was there, George Noory came, and George, my son and I went over to his luncheon. We stopped to say hi and take some pictures, and George looked at me and said, "You're the flip side guy." Like, well, you know, what are you doing here? And I got a call last night from George's producer saying, would you come on the show next Wednesday night? So I will be on Coast to Coast, 10 p.m. Los Angeles time next Wednesday. They said, what do you want to talk about? And I said, you know what? I want to talk about aliens and this research, because fans of Divine Counsels in the Afterlife, Architecture of the Afterlife, occasionally aliens, whatever you want to call that, show up in people's councils. So like this wise being, you know, they're talking to the wisest beings who've been watching over all their lifetimes, and they'll say, well, this is weird. I'm seeing a person who looks like this.
Yeah.
Anyway, and Jennifer and I have had so many great conversations that I will stop in 2 seconds.
I would love to be in on that conversation.
Stephen Hawking came through in a conversation that you and I had, and I asked him if he'd seen any aliens, and his reply was, we are all aliens. because we choose to incarnate from somewhere else. So I thought, well, if I'm going to talk next Wednesday about it, maybe Luana and her peeps want to help me. So, or whatever. What do you want to talk about, Lou?
They said no. They don't want to help you at all.
They're not, they don't want to talk about that. Okay.
No, hold on. Hold on a second. No, no. They're, of course, kidding. They're just like, no.
And yes, of course, it would be great to have you on that show.
Okay, so the very first class that you guys had, or the very first thing that you guys went to, they're just, she's talking about. So give me a second. I just need to work this out. Were you there for 2 days or just 1 day?
Yeah, we were there for really three days, 2.5 days.
3 days. Okay. They kind of said that. So they said the first day.
And the first hour person we went to see was the son of J. Allen Hynek, which is the guy who invented the term close encounters of the third kind.
Okay, so that's what they want.
Okay.
Okay. I'm not gonna judge it. Richard Dreyfus, is he alive or gone?
Richard Dreyfus is still on the planet.
Okay. Hold on.
And he's in Close Encounters of the Third Kind.
He is. Okay. Just wanted to make sure, because they just showed me a picture of Richard Dreyfus, and I was just trying to figure out where.
By the way, does J. Allen Hynek want to come through? Is that, because that would be related. He's in the movie Close Encounters. Okay. You're tapping your nose? That means that is correct.
You know, I have no idea who he is.
Okay. No. Well, we have him. You don't remember, but we've had a conversation with him because it startled me. Movie recently, and there he was in the movie, and he was my science counselor mentor when I was in seventh grade. When I won the state science fair, he was the scientist assigned to me who helped me to plan, you know, what my science project was going to be. And so I didn't put it together that he was the guy who invented the term close encounters of the third kind and wrote, you know, he was part of Project Blue Book. But J. Allen Hynek, please, I'll stop talking. You have the floor, sir. Would you tell us?
He says it was a fabulous weekend.
What did you think of your son's presentation?
He said there was more aliens there than people.
That's funny.
That's funny. He said it was, what? It was too long.
Okay, I know what he's talking about, because at some point people start repeating.
I don't know. And so, hold on. He did a wonderful job, but he should have cut it in half. Or at least had like intermission or something.
Oh, his son? Between. Yeah, they would do this thing where they would have him go from one conference to the next conference to like a workshop. So it would be like 8 hours a day of him nonstop talking. We just stopped to see like a 2-hour presentation. It was fantastic, but
he covered almost everything. What's that? So he didn't cover the afterlife?
No, they don't cover that.
Okay.
They just cover.
That's what he said. He goes, they covered almost everything, but not the afterlife. He's like, that's kind of silly.
And may I ask you, sir, why is that silly? I have an idea of why it's silly, but what would your word be for that?
It's an important component for people to feel connected to the afterlife. Because people in the afterlife are technically aliens to people here now.
Well, also this idea that we bring a portion of our conscious energy to a lifetime. And from what we learn in the research is that everyone does that, including aliens. So they have a higher self that incarnates on their planet or whatever.
Okay, so they're putting me, myself in my mind's eye. So just give me a second. I don't know what you're talking about. They said that I had a very difficult time connecting in this incarnation to people here. I did, I guess. They're right. They said it was something that you felt was missing, because I always felt like something was missing growing up that wasn't from here. And there's a lot of people that don't feel comfortable in their own skin that live here. I mean, I'm asking, why are they saying this? Like, so why are you bringing me up, or why are you saying this?
Yeah, what's the connection?
The connection is I talk to the afterlife, but I also know now, which I've known all along, but it really is more apparent now than ever, how vast our universe is. And that's because I've been talking to the afterlife. And I believe that's a very integral part of our connections to aliens, I guess.
Well, if I may, I think he's referring to, and correct me if I'm wrong, he's referring to the idea that as a medium, your filters of your brain are off kilter, the way the rest of us have filters that block information. And so if we could telepathically communicate with trees, with animals, with aliens telepathically, then we would be aware of so much more because, but these filters
Yeah.
that block, our awareness. So that idea that you had a hard time because your filters were off, you see.
Yeah.
So I think what he's
Yeah.
saying is
Yeah.
you can train yourself to get to bypass those filters to communicate with people telepathically or your loved ones or et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah.
So my question to you is, and this comes from a Carl Sagan quote that I was looking at yesterday, which is, why is it there's not more evidence or simple things that people can point to that show that either other dimensional creatures or et cetera have shown up here? And that's my question to Jay Allen.
We do not have the sophisticated tools to capture the evidence, for starters. They looked at, they're like, well, you give evidence from the other side, but you can't capture it, right? How do you capture that evidence? I'm just giving it verbally,
Yeah, like a
right?
subjective experience. Correct.
It's a subjective experience, and even the information I get is subjective, or it's my interpretation, right?
Exactly.
And I could. I could totally be wrong in the interpretation when things come through. But I'm getting better at it. Hold
Well,
on.
that's generous
They're
of you to say,
laughing.
because you are so right on the money so often.
We should speak more to the councils in the afterlife about how we here can get information that proves that they're aliens among us.
Okay, and so if I may clarify, you're saying that in terms of this idea of us talking to people off planet and then getting that information and then comparing those reports to thousands of others, let's say, you're tapping your nose, meaning that's right on the money. When you look at
Yeah.
those, and it's a quote in Dr. Grayson's book, After, he's the NDE guy. And he said, you can get objective data, evidence, from subjective experiences if you ask the same questions to everybody who's had the experience. So the idea is Jennifer, let's say a number of different Jennifers out there who talk to the
Okay.
same people, they give you the same testimony, and then you can compare the answer.
Right.
Go ahead.
They want to test out the theory. So we should ask, what question would you ask, Richard?
Okay, well, so the question would be, people have had these experiences for a long time of, let's say, abductions.
That's just what happened. He just showed me somebody getting taken up into a spaceship. So hold on a second. I believe
Okay.
that's our question. Oh, okay. Then how? That's interesting. He says, yes, they do get taken to spaceships, but not in the way that we think that they do. So it's more like their
An
spirit,
etheric.
their body.
Yeah,
Yes.
their spirit is taken
Yes.
up. That was my guess because I've talked to a number of people who've had those experiences, and when they talk about them, I ask, can you see your body still in bed while you're up in the spaceship? And they don't, because we don't talk about this, how your consciousness can leave your
Right.
body or there's a portion in your, we don't really talk about this. So conceptually, it's hard to imagine that you could be taken up into a ship and still be in bed. And so then the question
Right.
is, if they're probing you, let's say, if that's the case, are they're probing like I guess an etheric version. Go
My
ahead.
gosh, I just saw Saturday Night Live. Sorry, the skit on Saturday Night Live, which is hilarious about how they get abducted. And how she just like they just came in here and took me and played with my boobs. Like it was the funniest thing I've ever
I
seen.
remember that.
You
Yeah.
guys should research that SNL and abductions. Okay. There's no way I could think that, but that was just somebody up there. I thought it was really funny. Go ahead.
But that idea
I
of so what if
digress.
what so I and I've talking I've talking I've spoken to people who've had that experience, and including once they're in the ship, I ask them then to address the people that are in the ship and ask them questions and say, who are you? Are you guys tourists? Or are we familiar with each other? And every time I've done that, they report that this person that they're taking up to the ship, they know them from previous lifetimes. They've actually incarnated on the other planet more often than here.
And they are showing me that I can see why it's such a scary experience. They rewire their bodies. So maybe that to avoid, I don't know, test out things from there to here. I don't know.
Well, I've read
rewiring their spirit, their etheric body.
Their etheric body. Well, I asked the question. So I asked these people aboard the ship, are you strangers? Are you tourists? And they always say, no, we've come to gather information. And then I ask, what's the process? And they describe something along the lines of scanning, like rewiring. Mm-hmm. And they download information into the person so that they know what to get the next time they stop by. So they upload that information. So it's like it's almost like a computer process, a USB port that you're going back and forth.
Yeah.
And so then the question is, what's the content of the information? And let's ask J. Allen Hynek, what's the purpose of these kinds of trips from your perspective, if there is any purpose?
The purpose is always twofold. So we get a better knowledge on their end about how spirits can travel out of their body. We know when people have comas, that's what happens. I've witnessed that with a few people, as well as dementia. We've talked about that. We've covered that.
Yeah, that most of their consciousness is already outside their body, while a little bit remains in coma victims and dementia patients.
But we want to know why someone would leave their body to go on a spaceship. Like the research involved with that. So for that side, you know, I guess looking at the Akashic records and finding out, you know, is how this happened, or have they been on the spaceship before? Just like with what you said before.
And a lot of times they'll say, like, as children, they were visited as children. But what they aren't aware of is that they may have incarnated on the very planet these people are from, and they're mm-hmm. friends, and now they're stopping by to gather their friends. Now, this is another question for you, J. Allen Hynek. And it was your son brought it up that, you know, AI, you know, artificial intelligence, seems to be a little bit like what a pattern might be in a civilization, that eventually we get to that, and that we might send probes out into the universe using AI, so that some of the aliens who may show up here might be more AI generated from somebody in another time zone, another time frame. Is that the case?
There's different degrees I'm getting. Let me make sure. They just showed me Neanderthal, like a Neanderthal.
Okay.
And like different stages versions. Of evolution.
Very good. I've heard that different too versions. In the research, by the way.
I have not.
Okay.
Huh. I don't know if we discussed how I read someone that was a great-great-granddaughter.
Yes.
Okay.
Of Darwin.
So he just came. Darwin just showed up and reminded me how the book, he actually wanted it to be called Organs of Spirit, not Species.
Right. He said that before. I don't know if you remember that.
Yeah.
But Charles, can we ask you a couple of questions? Because we don't get to talk to you too often. What was it like for you when you crossed over to see how things worked?
Terrible. Oh, this is funny. Hold on. I haven't heard that word. It was nothing I anticipated.
Oh, wow. Why is that? Just because you weren't aware of any of it, or it was all new?
It was strikingly beautiful. A place with unimaginable colors and music and sound and livelihood, like all different kinds of, talking about the different kinds of races here, he's like up that by a trillion, like the different species, the different kinds of humans, the different kind of aliens.
Your work was cut out for you, sir, on the flip side.
Yeah.
And are you continuing your work in any way? I mean, the kind of person that you are?
Origins of Spirit is his new book. Yes, he's continuing. He's
Wow.
Like, it's infinitesimal.
And well, let me ask you, have you chosen to
incarnate? He said, he goes, every time he incarnates, he says it's just one little chapter of this long book that he wants. Oh, that's so interesting. So Origins of Species could be the first one. The next one, when he incarnates, will be another version of another, you know, he just says that if I do this every single lifetime, it'll never be done.
The research is ongoing. Well, that's brilliant. And imagine if
you with the afterlife, us with the afterlife, right?
Well, imagine for a moment that, you know, you could remember. We bypass the filters and we see the books that we've written in previous lifetimes. I mean, I do recall, you know, somebody who wrote books in the 15th century, and I can't read them because they're in Latin. But whatever, you know, I mean, I think it's fascinating.
You're a Catholic boy.
That's
Catholic,
right.
Boy.
I should read some of Latin, but they're pretty thick. Well, I guess I have another question for you, Jay Allen. Excuse me, Charles. We appreciate that. Let's say anything else you want to talk about, or can I ask Jay Allen Hynek another question?
I'm going to go ahead. He's just stopping by saying that his work will never be done.
Thank you so much.
That was, and just to remind us.
There was also another person that we talked to or listened to. His name is Matthew James Bailey, and he's an ethicist about artificial intelligence. And he talks about the divine spark, which is what Jennifer and I talk about, really. And is there anything you'd like to say, Luana or the class or anybody, in terms of what he had to say about artificial intelligence?
And Matthew James Bailey is here or over there?
He's here on the planet, and he spoke at the conference talking about the...
Oh, got it. Got it. Missed that. All right. They're laughing. Like, AI is ridiculous if you think about it. What was that? So they showed me AI with us talking, and then the aliens listening, and then people listening to the aliens, and then, like, it's never ending. So to them... AI is just a term for, it's something we all need to learn from one another.
Well, okay, just
it is already gone. So they said it was, yeah, like it's already gone too far. I'm like, has it gone too far? I'm like, it's already gone too far, but on terms that we can't understand. I mean, they showed me like the 16th century. Like, I don't know.
Well, it's interesting because, of course, as you and I have learned, and this was something that came up in one of the talks, there are no secrets. When you're talking about what we're doing, there are no secrets on the flip side, which is really problematic for, you know, people in the intelligence agencies, because you can ask people on the flip side the truth of what happened. Of course, they're giving it to you, you're translating it, you're getting your best guess of what they're trying to tell you. But this idea that we can access higher intelligence, whether it's alien or et cetera, or even talking to J. Allen Hynek, who departed the planet some years ago. What have you been doing, sir? Have you been continuing, like Charles Darwin, to write and...
He says helping my family.
Helping your family. Cool.
Oh, that's interesting. Thank you. He says he's learning more about what he could do when he comes back. The research that he does, that's how our dreams happen. He's showing me like a circle. So the research that he's doing, maybe about other species elsewhere or other aliens elsewhere, and then he showed me Avatar, things like that. Like, he eventually will come back and then he'll get this great idea to write a movie. He'll get this great idea, you know, to do this, to research more about it. Kind of like you in the afterlife. You know, plunking down in your head. That took thousands of years, they're saying.
Thousands of years of information. Yeah, of course. Well, let me ask you that, sir. Would, just in terms of close encounters, this idea of, and people ask about it, will there be an event where that's different from what we're talking about, which is sort of etheric?
Go ahead. They just showed me Will Smith in the 4th of July or something. I don't know. President's Day. He was in a movie with aliens that came down to attack
Oh, Will
I don't
Smith.
know.
Yeah, Independence Day. So like that. Will there be that event? Will something like that
No.
occur? Or no, no event like
no.
that.
No, there are unspoken rules that are set in place to keep, because we don't need to destroy the earth. You guys are doing just fine.
Well, that I guess what the question is then, just to change it a little bit, will this research that Jennifer and I are talking about, where we are talking to learning new information from people that aren't on the planet, will this become more commonplace so that it becomes something people will use as a tool?
Yeah, it's interesting. Yes, it's interesting because they're showing me like the fairylands, like that people don't believe in fairies, but the ones that do remember the fairyland. So there is a different dimension that holds the fairies in the Mother Earth. You know, it's so, okay, it's so interesting. Give me a second. The things that we dream about, or the things that we daydream about, or that we go to sleep and we think that we're, you know, there's monsters or whatever, it might actually be another dimension that we're crashing into. And
so,
we come,
so,
how many people
so
wake up with
other,
these ideas? Yes, those
sorry,
other realms.
Those other realms exist, and we're tapping, you and I are tapping into them, but eventually will others be able to do so sort of at will?
They already are, but they just don't remember. They get their, now it's sounding like a conspiracy. Yeah. They get their brains wiped. They don't. They just don't remember.
So, but J. Allen Hynek, one last question about men in black. Now we've heard that term and people.
Everything's true.
Is what he says?
Everything's true. Give me a second. He's like, more so than you think. He said, you said it, but you don't believe it. But he goes, more so than you think.
More so than you think, meaning our government does have secret programs that they keep from the public. Is that what you mean? Is that what you're saying?
All the way back to the Knights Templar. Yes.
All the way back to the Knights Templar. All right. Very good. I appreciate that. I mean, it's an unusual. Anything you want to say to Paul? I mean, I'll probably be talking to him soon.
Tell Paul I love how he's coming to his own. He went through a lot.
And you have another son who's an Oscar award winning guy who worked on with movies.
I think that's funny because he's saying, he's like, yeah, he doesn't really believe in it, but he likes make believe.
You
like
mean
he
the
doesn't,
other son,
you know,
the other son. I see. Yeah.
The other son.
I think you had four kids. They all are MIT, you know, PhD, et cetera, et cetera. And Paul,
he says he had five.
Do you remember me? That's my question for you. You remember you? You know, I was.
He just showed me you on TV with our guy,
Charles Grodin.
Chuck.
Yeah, when I
Charles,
was. I was probably 20 then, but you knew me when I was 14. So whatever. Yes, I was.
Oh yeah, yeah. You actually said that. You did say that early on.
I mean, I'm just trying to get like.
Yes, he said that you never stopped asking questions back then.
It's true. He came over
eventually,
to our house.
He showed me. He just gave you a bunch of papers or gave you something so to shut you up for a little bit.
Well, it's interesting because
you went through it so fast.
I asked Paul about your pipe because you used to smoke your Borkum Riff over in our living room, and your son said that your wife didn't really care for the pipe smoke around the house, so you didn't get to use it so much, but you had it in your mouth in Close Encounters of the Third Kind. Anyway, anything about pipes
that
just
is
before
funny.
We go? Are you smoking pipes over there?
Peace pipes are better.
Peace pipe.
And a little ayahuasca can't hurt, apparently. That's not a pipe, so I'm not sure.
There was a conference about DMT, of talking to the aliens or people, you know, using DMT. Well, Luana, is there anything else? Go ahead.
He just said they're easy to snatch.
What does he mean?
The people using DMT, like he's making fun of aliens snatching people.
Oh, I see.
Like,
okay. Well, Luana, is there anything else, anybody else that, or in this topic that we should cover?
Okay. So I don't. JFK, his son,
RFK Jr.
What is
you mean
RFK
Jr. son John? I'm sorry,
John. Give me a second. John has showed up a couple of times. I just need to understand, and I have a feeling I understand, but I'm not sure. Hold on. Okay, never mind. I have a client that's doing something, a documentary,
Oh,
and it
okay. Then
deals.
John wanted to talk about
So,
that. Okay,
yep.
very good. You know, John, we haven't asked
That's
John,
up.
but can I ask him one question?
Sure.
What was it like when you crossed over? Who was there to greet you?
It was fucking scary. Sorry about the F word. But how he died, he's like, what do you expect? It wasn't all bliss right away.
How long did
He
it take
said
for you to sort of transition to
a millisecond.
a millisecond?
But he just said he didn't pay attention to the signs, literally.
We have a mutual friend, Daryl. I went to college with her, and I know you dated her.
Yes, Mrs. Hannah.
Say again?
Is it Daryl Hannah
Yeah.
you're talking about? Yeah.
Anything you want to say to Daryl?
He's saying that she hasn't aged a bit.
Sweet. And when are you coming back,
Again,
John? You left way too early. What's going on, brother? When are you coming back?
he's never, he says he's all done. He
Right.
doesn't know when.
And what
He
was it
doesn't
like
know
to
when.
hang out with your dad again?
Peaceful. To see everything in front of us was incredibly. There are no words. I'm seeing them like in a conference room with the TVs like all around, with the life review and their group. Like, I guess there's a group. This is the first time I've seen that, a group life review.
So
And
everybody's
so,
around watching all of their journeys together.
yeah,
Did
that's for
you had a
support
lifetime
piece.
with your dad before? That's my question.
Yes, but I still didn't know him then. Like it
Oh,
was very
same
short.
time period, but you weren't connected. Wow. And
It
how
was
about
very
your
short.
mom? How about your mom? What was it like seeing your mom again?
He's just showing me. It's better to show me the feelings like when she walked in, how much love was given to her and how much his awareness of what she went through and just she's an idol over there, apparently. Yeah,
Sweet.
that's pretty amazing. Yeah. And the music that played for her was pretty spectacular. Huh.
So,
Yeah.
this is an example of how I grab hold of Jennifer's leg and hold on until I can't
I
ask
know.
questions. Anyway, thank your client who we pushed off into the ethers. I appreciated everybody who stopped by. John Jr. Wow, we haven't chatted before, and you're always welcome. Please, we'd like to talk to you more if you have time. J. Allen Hynek, thank you so much. Appreciate all your wisdom. Who else? Who am I forgetting? Oh, Luana.
Darwin,
Oh, and
Charles
Charles
Darwin,
Darwin. Thank you.
Luana.
How could I forget him?
Yes.
The origin of
I
spirit.
don't know. They just put that in my head, so it makes it easy for me. Because if
I
you asked me who wrote, like, I wouldn't even be able to tell you, or Richard Dreyfus, like, I wouldn't even, but they brought me to Richard Dreyfus. I didn't realize what was
Yeah,
going on, but I
no,
just
from the
kind of.
movie. Anyway, thank you guys so much. Luana, thank you for.
And congratulations to our 150 plus episodes.
Oh my God,
Woo!
yes, we've got so many episodes, and now we're going to have more viewers. And anyway, this is an easy thing for everyone to do. Your loved ones are close by. Pick up the phone, lines are open, ask them questions, and see what they have to say. Or just call Jennifer. We love you.
Bye, sweetheart.
Bye.
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 This has been Hacking the Afterlife podcast with Jennifer Shaffer. For more information, jenniferschaffer.com, martinizone.com, or richmartini.com. Hacking the Afterlife documentary is available on gaia.com via Amazon Prime.